Hey guys, welcome back. So today we're out at the range to talk about one of the most innovative small arms designs of the 20th century. If you watch the Military Arms channel, you might have an idea what's in this Pelican case in front of me. Let's just go ahead and open it up. You know, in the age of rifles and all that good stuff, it just seems like the Bullpup doesn't get the love that it deserves in the 21st century. Now, in the 20th century, the Bullpup came to prominence. Probably one of the most prolific would be the 1977 era Steyr AUG. We do have one of those out here this afternoon for our discussion. But as we move into the 21st century, Bullpups really haven't gained much in popularity. Now, they've definitely grabbed some more market share in the United States. But as far as military adoption, things like that, we see countries like France that once used Bullpups now moving over to 416s, H&K, M4-style rifles, if you will, conventional rifles. So what is it about the Bullpup that people like me love, and what is it about the Bullpup that people dislike, and why is it not a very popular, shall I say, military service rifle? Let's dig into that subject in today's video.
American Hartford Gold is dedicated to helping individuals and families invest in precious metals. This includes gold, silver, platinum, in both bars and coins. They provide both physical delivery to one's doorstep or inside of a retirement account like an IRA, 401k, or TSP. American Hartford Gold helps clients achieve greater security for their future by adding a safe haven asset to their portfolio. Investors receive only the highest quality gold and silver coins offered at competitive prices with 100% customer satisfaction guaranteed. American Hartford Gold has an excellent Trustpilot rating from over 1,000 customers. They're A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau. They have a price match guarantee, a buyback commitment, and free maintenance and storage for up to 3 years. American Hartford Gold has a special offer for Military Arms Channel viewers of up to $5,000 in free silver on qualified orders. So please call 866-406-1988 today, or text military to 65532. Again, that is 866-406-1988, or text military to 65532. So please swing by and check out American Hartford Gold. I will put a link in the video description below.
So let's go back in time a little bit. Back in the 1970s, the Austrians came up with this beautiful polymer and aluminum and steel package, and it's called the Steyr AUG, but affectionately called the AUG here in the United States, and the Austrians don't like that much, but I'm getting off in the weeds there a little bit. The AUG really kind of opened the door for allied nations of ours exploring the concept of a bullpup in military service. And so other nations would go on to adopt it, not just the Austrians, but the Australians, the Brits, the French, they all adopted a bullpup. And there's other nations as well that I've left out, but it just hasn't really stuck, right? So if you take a look at today, as I've mentioned before, you know, the French, they're moving away from the FAMAS and the F1, the F2 rifles, the bullpups, and they're moving into an M4 type rifle with the HK416. And so we're seeing countries even like the Brits that are playing with conventional M4 style rifles, although they're still fielding a bullpup. But there were a number of different things these early rifles didn't have in terms of features that people that used conventional rifles insisted the bullpup should have, or the bullpup should just be completely disregarded as an option, both for self-defense and for military applications. But in the world of civilian shooting, like myself, the bullpup really does appeal to me, but there's certain aspects to the design that the military probably will never get over. And by the military, I mean the U.S. military. It's tied to a number of different things. We're going to explore that in the next segment. So the U.S. military is steeped in tradition. If you ever served in the military, you'll probably remember countless hours marching around in circles and practicing things like right shoulder arms, left shoulder arms, order arms, parade rest, things like that. And those are things that we've been doing for a long time, since our founding, because rifles traditionally have had a barrel in front of the receiver, going back all the way to our muzzle loaders that we founded our nation with. So when you start to shorten the rifle a whole bunch, things like order arms becomes quite difficult, because right here, I'm 6'4", I have my rifle basically by the front sight post. Now, if I go to parade rest and you push that rifle out, you can still grab it by the barrel, right? Now, let's see what that looks like with a bullpup. The X95 is easily one of my favorite bullpups. This little guy, believe it or not, has a 16-inch barrel. It's a tiny, tiny little rifle. Now, military X95s can have as short as 13-inch barrels. So the guns get really, really short, because keep in mind, the U.S. and the civilian world, we have to play by overall length requirements and barrel length requirements that the military doesn't have to play by. So many times, Bullpups won't always have a full 16-inch barrel. They may have something shorter. But here we have a 16-inch barreled rifle, which will drive the point home. So if I want to go to order arms using U.S. military rifle doctrine, it would look something like that. And parade rest would look something like that. Now, the Brits have definitely come up with their own manual of arms. But keep in mind, again, the U.S. military, traditionally speaking, this is how we wind up with weapon systems like the M14. Right? You had the military thinking of, well, the M1 Garand got us through World War II and through Korea. We need to just keep the M1 Garand, put a box magazine in it, shorten it a little bit, update the gas system, call it the M14, and we're good. Clinging to wooden steel when clearly the trend was towards either stamped rifles or machined aluminum and polymers. And so the U.S. military clings to its tradition and its history. And I think that has a lot to do with why the U.S. military just turns its nose up to bullpups. But there are probably other functional reasons why they don't like it either. But let's talk about some of the misconceptions that people have about bullpups and maybe some of the early problems that bullpups have that have long since been rectified. So just for reference, let's take a look at the X95 with its 16-inch barrel next to an AR-15A2 with a 20-inch barrel. You can see how much shorter it is. Now, if you shorten this down to a 14.5 M4, you're still going to have 4 or 5 inches difference, where the M4 is longer than the bullpup with the longer barrel. So bullpups definitely have an advantage in length, but they also have an advantage in balance. So this rifle, most of the weight is back here, so I can actually have it in my shoulder and hold it in my shoulder for an extended period of time, and it's not going to become uncomfortable. As a matter of fact, as I pointed out before, I can fire one-handed with this and actually engage targets out to 100 yards. I still have my left hand free to grab doors, grab people, things like that. So the bullpup has those advantages. When a traditional rifle, there's so much weight forward that this is going to become fatiguing very, very quickly. Even with an M4, especially when you have accessories on it, it's going to become very nose heavy. So holding it in the shoulder for any length of time one-handed really isn't going to be practical. But it's not like you do a whole lot of fighting one-handed anyway, but it's just something to point out. So let's talk about some of the traditional problems with bullpups that people have a problem with. But these have been rectified for the most part. So let's take a look at the Styrog, for example. Now, even a better example of this is, again, we can't get on the civilian market here in the United States, which is the SA-80, which is the British bullpup rifle that they use, or the 85, which is the later version HK helped them with. That rifle literally only ejects out the right-hand side. It's basically an AR-180 in a bullpup chassis, and there's no facilities for it to eject out the left-hand side. So if you're a left-handed shooter and you go into the British military, you just became a right-handed shooter, and that can be a problem for some of the recruits, right? But the AUG, even though it's, you know, designed in 1977, you could put a left-hand bolt in it, take the gun apart, put the left-hand bolt in it, and configure it to eject out the left-hand side. But what you could not do with the bullpup was move this charging handle over to the right-hand side. So if you're a left-handed shooter, this becomes quite awkward, right? You definitely want to be able to move that over here. So they tried to address some of the shortcomings of the design with the AUG, but it still had those shortcomings. Now, another thing that people would ding the bullpup for is trigger. The AUG had a very mushy, mechanically feeling trigger. It was just bad. Now, aftermarket triggers would come out later. You could replace your trigger pack and get a much better trigger pull. But the original military triggers were really difficult. Then you go into the fact that these things had a two-stage trigger for semi and full auto. So you just pull the trigger halfway and it's semi-automatic. You pull it all the way to the rear, it becomes fully automatic. That could be very problematic for a lot of folks as well. So they're just those types of issues. Now, if you go fast forward into a more modern design like the X95, when talking about the trigger pull was improved over the AUG just out of the factory box. But Geissele triggers also exist for these rifles that you can drop it in there and literally gives it a match grade trigger. So the concern that triggers are gritty, spongy, not good triggers, the MDR, X95 with the Geissele trigger, all sorts of rifles out there nowadays, they've really kind of rectified that. Also, with regards to right and left hand ejection, the X95, like the AUG, you can put a left hand bolt in it, pop this cover off, put it on the other side, and now it will eject out the left hand side. But I can also take the charging handle. It's not done during a field strip, it's a little bit more involved, but you take the charging handle and move it over to the other side of the gun, and now it's truly set up for a left-handed user. Guns that would come along after the X95, not too much longer after the X95, like the VHS that I have here, this gun can be set up to eject either out the right-hand side or the left-hand side. Its charging handle is already ambi just by its very design, It can be set up to eject out either side of the rifle very easily during a field strip, no tools required. And we show you how to do that in the full video review that we did on the 60-inch barrel version of this gun. Also, people would complain about the magazines in the Bullpup. They said that magazine changes were unintuitive and difficult to do, and that's just a training issue. That's simply not true. If you ask me, one of the things that you'll see some trainers teaching people to do on magazine reloads on a rifle is to bring the rifle up like this so you can see the magazine, put it in, drop the bolt, and go back to shooting, right? Not all trainers, but some trainers will teach you that. With the Bullpup, when I rotate the rifle, this is already in my workspace, right? So right here, it's right by my face where I can see it. I don't even have to do one of these, right? All I gotta do is just look down. It's right there. So in the dark, whatever, I can get that magazine in the gun. Also, with the Steyr AUG, the magazine is ambi on it, right? So you just push on it from either side and it'll drop the magazine out. Same thing with the VHS. It has a magazine release right there. You can pinch it from either side. The magazine will drop right out, very ambi friendly. So the magazine change for me is a training issue. If anything, I believe the Bullpup has a slight advantage over a conventional rifle like the M16 and being a little bit easier to reload once you get acclimated to it. Now, if you're used to this and been using it for 30 years, like myself, it is a hard transition. Just apply a little bit of time, maybe get some training, and that will be rectified. Now, if you take a look at the X95, another thing that's really kind of cool about this is that where rifles like this aren't very left-hand friendly, if you take a look at the M16 in its original design, the T-handle really kind of favors a right-handed shooter. The ping-pong paddle, all the controls on the gun, even the fact that it only has a select lever on one side, which you can obviously remedy, the gun was definitely set up to favor right-handed shooters, but left-handed shooters with the A2 could find solace in the fact that even though the military still hadn't put a selector lever over here, they put a brass deflector here to keep it from throwing brass back in the shooter's face. So you had that brass deflector. That was the idea of making this ambi. More modern rifles like this, I've already talked about how you swap the bolts around, things like that, move the charging handles around. They came out of the box with the ability to put an ambi selector on here. All you do is take a pin, like a paper clip, push on this, slide it out, slide another selector lever in, or move this one over, just grab a second one out of the bin. It just takes seconds to do. A couple other things that people have said online as negatives towards the Bullpup are things like a decreased sight radius. So if I were to put iron sights on this, put one back here and one here, the sight radius is about the same length as, you know, the tip of my finger to my thumb. It's a very short sight radius, which I guess could be an issue, but in the age of modern optics and red dot sights and things like that, I don't see that as a major issue. Iron sights are really relegated to backup sights. You're gonna rely on something like this Elcan. So I don't really put too much stock in that, but I can see what they're talking about. If you take a look at where the sights would fall on this M16A2 or AR-15A2, rear sight back here, front sight all the way out here. Well, unless I put an extension on the barrel of the Tavor, or I'm sorry, the X95, there's no way I'm gonna get that same sight radius. So again, when you compress this down to an M4, it's not that big of a deal. So I don't really put too much stock in that one. The other one that people will talk about is like, well, I don't like shooting bullpups because I have the ejection port right by my face, and if the gun blows up, it's gonna blow my face off. Yeah, I mean, I scoured the internet trying to find pictures of bullpups blown up and people bleeding from the face, and I've yet to find one. Now, I know for example, or for a fact, I should say, that the X95 is designed to take an overpressure round. They test the gun by causing a barrel obstruction, and they blow the gun up on purpose to test it, and we've seen somebody do this with reloads, and it does work. When the gun detonates and it blows up, it goes off out of battery or anything like that, it gets a wildly overpressured load, the bolt and carrier will seize in the receiver. So nothing's gonna blow out here. It's all wrapped in aluminum and steel. It's gonna seize in the receiver. You're gonna have to send it to IWI to unseize it to fix the gun, but the gun simply will not blow up in your face. So you can literally pound bullets into the barrel, fire around, obstruct the barrel, and the gun's not gonna blow your face off. Now, I can't say that that's the case for all bullpups, like for the VHS. I don't know what the design is. I only know what the X95 is because we actually had a customer blow one up and I had to talk to IWI about it. And they're like, oh yeah, the reason it's seized is because it's designed to do that. It literally won't blow up in your face. So all the things that people have historically dinged it for outside of military circles in the civilian world, really most of those issues have been resolved. The issues of ambi controls, the issues of ejection port, right or left-hand side, triggers, all that stuff has been addressed with more modern designs. So the Bullpup really makes a lot of sense, especially for me. Now, I understand why the military may not want to consider them, but in the civilian world, guns like this, once they're configured the way that you want them, of course, I've changed the pistol grip on this one. I've added this LBL bipod to it and things like that. This is just a really, really cool, small, handy package that's well-suited for vehicle operation, CQB, working inside of structures, things like that. Yet it still has the range and effectiveness of a much bigger rifle simply because we've moved everything backwards into the stock area. This is just wasted space for, you know, the military. It's a great place to put M&Ms and crayons, but other than that, there's really not, this is all wasted space. The Bullpup moves that action back into that wasted space and gives you a much shorter weapon. So I think we've pretty much addressed all the things that the military might have concerns with, U.S. military, and things that civilians might have concerns with regards to bullpups. But I look forward to your comments down below because I'm sure you guys will bring up something that we've overlooked in this video. Haven't done it on purpose. These are all the things that we could come up with today, but I look forward to reading those comments. What do you think about the bullpup? Do you like it? I'm a huge fan. I love hunting with bullpups. My MDR is easily one of my favorite hunting rifles. I've often considered and have used bullpups like the X95 as a defensive rifle. You can also get them in .308. You don't just have to run it in .556. They do make the T7, which is a full power cartridge, a .308 cartridge. So bullpups are available not just in intermediate cartridges, but now you can get them in .308s. Kel-Tec makes a .308 bullpup as well. So what is it about the bullpup that you don't like? Because I know you guys are out there and you're just itching to comment, so do comment down below. If you guys like to support us here at the Military Arms Channel so we can continue to bring you content like this, consider becoming part of our Patreon family. Again, there's a link down below. Also right here on YouTube, you got the thanks and the join button underneath the video player you're watching right now. Mash either one of those buttons and you can support us right here on YouTube in the age of demonetization. Last but not least, please swing by and check out Copper Custom. Thank you for 15 years of support and we'll talk to you guys soon.